إنما يريد الله ليذهب عنكم الرجس أهل البيت ويطهركم تطهيرا. Tonight's Thursday night program has been dedicated in the name of our seventh Imam, Imam Musa al-Kazim alayhi salatu wasalam. And I'll come to the reason why we are dedicating that this gathering in his name at the end of my talk, which is about the difference in the religious observation as far as historical events are concerned among the Shia communities around the world. Let me, as a preamble, just try to explain that, you know, there was a time when the world was not that much interconnected to one another. People did not know much about other nations, and the means of communication from one place to another, or one community to another, was not that easy those days. No, you know, mailing system or postage or telegram, nothing was there those days. And when you look at it from the religious perspective, you see that each Shia community, they were mostly confined to their own geographical area. And during their entire life, from the beginning to the end, they only interacted with their own ethno-cultural people. The only time they would go to other places would be when they go for mostly for Hajj or Ziyarat, which was not as common as it is now, you know, with the affluence and the speed in traveling these days. MashaAllah, you know, Ziyarat trips and groups have increased many, many times. If you bring somebody who lived 100 years ago, and now he will say you are very lucky. Because those days, even to go for Wajib Hajj meant that you had to spend about at least 2 to 3 months in the journey, because you will be traveling by road or train or ship, you know, going there many, many weeks ahead and then stay there long until you get the return, you know, fare as far as the shipping system is concerned. And so, you know, those days people lived in their own areas, confined to their own religious, ethno-cultural, you know, communities. So, for example, the Shias in Iraq would not much know about the Shias of Afghanistan, the Shias in Lebanon, or the Shias in Iran, or Afghanistan, or Bahrain, Bahrain and the eastern province of Arabia, which is actually one people, one tribe, one culture, actually. And then you go on to the India before the partition and the Khoja community in East Africa. You know, people lived among themselves in their own geographical confines. They spoke the same language, did things the way they had been doing from before. And, you know, those days, the local ulema or the scholars, you know, for example, in the Arab world, the Hawza of Najaf was still the main source of, you know, information for the Shias of the Arabic background, including Lebanon and Bahrain and Qatif. In Iran, they had their own scholars. In the Indian subcontinent, Lucknow was the kind of the capital of the Shias, with the Hawza and the religious, you know, leadership over there. These were the people who would basically, in the early days when these communities were formed, they would come with the understanding, okay, look at this event. Maybe there are three narrations on this issue. Then they, you know, the prominent alim of the time will decide, okay, we'll go with the second narration. And so the people in that area will start observing that religious event according to that, you know, designation made by that alim in their region. Maybe another alim in another region of the Shia world would have a different view, and they will go with the third hadith or the first one. And so you will see a same Shia community observing the same event in a different occasion. As far as they were, you know, not connected to one another, there were no issues. And this is not only, you know, a new problem. No, this has been there from day one. People like Sheikh Kulaini, the compiler of Usul al-Kafi. And then you have Mufid, just a generation or two after him. They have differences of the opinion based on the ahadith. And so this is where we see that, you know, it is the ulama in the regions who basically fix the dates of observing one event or another. Now, as long as, you know, people were in their own geographical confine, there were no issues. There was no problems at all, no tensions, no questions why we are doing this way and another community is doing it this way. This is a new phenomenon, and this is part of what is it means to migrate to the western part of the world. So you come to the west now, look at Toronto, for example. So you have Shias who come from East Africa. You have Shias who come from India and Pakistan. You have Shias who come to Toronto from Afghanistan. There are Shias who come from Iran, from Iraq, from Bahrain, from Lebanon. And these Shia communities, all in Toronto now, have their own, you know, religious centers. And they basically go back to what they used to do in their own, original homes. And this is where sometimes when we come to know about one another, we see, okay, you know, this is another Shia community. And they are also Shia Isna'ashari. There is no difference in the Aqidah. There is no difference even in the thought process of doing taqlid and fiqh. You know, but when it comes to historical events, how do you observe it? Sometimes you see the differences. And this is where I would like you to, you know, understand that this is because this is kind of a new phenomenon, or it's not a problem really, but it's a new issue which didn't exist, 50 years ago. For example, you know, some of the common dates in our calendar, if you look at the wafat of the second imam, in Iran, it is actually observed on the 28th of Safar. 28th of Safar is also the wafat of someone else. This is a question, huh? Huh? The Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they combine the wafat of Rasulullah and the wafat of Imam Hassan, very similar to the wiladat of Rasulullah and the wiladat of the sixth Imam. Now, this is in Iran. You go to India, there also you will see it's 28th Safar. But when it comes to us here at the moment, I'll come to the story later on. That's how we are having this event here. Fourth Imam's Wiladat. In Iran, and even we here observe that on 5th of Shaban. In India, if you look at their calendar that they have, it is on 15th of Jamadil Ula. The wafat of the fourth Imam, in Iran, they observe that on 12th of Muharram. Whereas in India, we do it on 25th of Muharram, which also we do it here. The sixth Imam's wafat, in Iran, they do it on 25th of Shawwal, which is according to our calendar here also. But in India, they do it on 15th of Shawwal. The wafat of the eighth Imam, in Iran, they observe that on 29th. We also do the same thing. But the people from Indian subcontinent, they observe that on 18th of Safar, before the Arba'een. When you look at the wafat of Bibi Zainab, salawatullah alayha, in Iran and North India, it is observed on the 15th of Rajab, which is coming soon. Whereas in South India, if you go to Hyderabad, they observe that on 24th of Safar. And this is where, I just wanted to show you that, you know, if you look at all these different ways that the Shias have their calendar to observe religious events, there is no unanimity as far as the calendars and the events are concerned. We have a special case when it comes to the wafat of Bibi Fatima Zahra, salawatullah alayha. There is one narration, third of Jamadi al-Ula, which is observed in Iran, Iraq, and North India. There is a version followed, and in the past, it was only, you know, either follow this one or that one. In South India and Hyderabad, they used to do the wafat of Bibi Fatima Zahra on the 13th of Jamadi al-Ula. Now, this is where I wanted to give you the example. Why these differences? The differences is not really an arbitrary, you know, decision by an individual. It is because of the difference in the narrations. Sometimes the difference is not even in the narrations in the ahadith. Sometimes the way it was written in the early days, the Kufi script without the nuqtas, you know, created two different readings of the same hadith. For example, if you look at Sheikh Kulaini, and in Usul al-Kafi, he says that the wafat of Bibi Fatima is on 13th of Jamadi al-Awwal. If you look at Sheikh Mufid, he says it is the 3rd of Jamadi al-Thani. Both are almost of the same time, a little bit a generation gap, and both are very well versed in hadith of the Ahlul Bayt. So what was the problem there? You look at Sheikh Kulaini. Sheikh Kulaini in his Usul al-Kafi is a narration from Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salatu wasalam, where the Imam says, Inna Fatima alayhi salam makathat ba'da Rasulillah sallallahu alayhi wasallam خمسة و و و و يوما. The hadith is saying that Fatima lived after Rasulullah certain numbers of days. Now, if you look at that, I have changed the fonts for the number there. Because the way Arabic was written those days was the Kufi style. And the Kufi style basically, doesn't have nuqtas. So you'll see Sheikh Kulaini is reading the same hadith, but he is reading it as khamsata wa sab'ina yawman, 75 days after wafat of Rasulullah. Mufid is reading the same hadith, and he is saying khamsata wa tis'ina yawman, 95 days after Rasulullah's wafat. And there we, that's where you get, you know, the third of Jamadi al-Ula. If you look at the in the bigger writings there, we have Khamsa is readable even without Nukta. Because, you know, this is a number that the Imam is talking about, and this you know, only goes to Khamsa. But the second one is all the matter of nuqta. The shape of that word would be same. If you put the nuqta after seen, it will be sab'een. If you put two nuqtas right in the beginning at the top, it will become tis'een. So the shape of that letter doesn't change. It is the nuqta where you are placing it. And this is where the confusion was, that if you read it is 75, then you get 75 days after Rasulullah. That takes you to 13th of Jamadil Ula. If you read it as 95, it takes you to 95 days after Rasulullah, and that will bring you to the 3rd of Jamadil Sani. So the main point here is that the Shias have to observe one or the other day. There shouldn't be, you know, friction about it. And the hadith doesn't actually tell us which day of which month. It only says numbers of days after the passing away of Rasulullah. And that is where you get this two different narration. Now in Iran, the most common day date which was observed, and we also here, we give prominence to that, preference to that, is the 3rd of Jamadil Thani. However, in Qum, the situation of Qum was slightly different. The Hausa used to observe both dates, 13th Jamadil Ula and the 3rd Jamadil Thani. And this is where gradually, you know, this tradition has become common during our days. Many of the Maraja actually have emphasized this, especially Ayatollah al-Uzma, Sheikh Wahid Khurasani. He puts emphasis that, you know, observe the wafat of Bibi on both these dates, 13 Jamadil Ula as well as the 3rd of Jamadil Thaniya. And this is where the most, you know, obvious issue is that if you go back maybe about 25 years ago, you will see that we were observing only one date. And even now that we do this issue of doing it 3 days or 5 days, some communities have started doing it Ashara. There's no problem. We don't object to anyone. The idea that I would like you to reflect on it and think about is that there is diversity in how the Shia community observes the religious events. And the reason is partly, you know, difference in the ahadith and the preference which was given by the ulama of those regions in the past. And this is what has been carried on till now. And now that we come to the western part of the world, you know, we see this diversity and difference. Living in Canada especially, we shouldn't be afraid of it. There's no need to fight about it, not say, oh, we are right and they are wrong. You know, let every community observe the way they want. The main point is that we have to keep remembering the events associated with the Prophet and his family, salawatullah alayhim ajma'in, salawat. Now, having difference in dates is one thing. It's more manageable. But when you have a problem where on the same day there is a celebration and a commemoration, this is where we are having this event today. You know, we here, as well as the Arab Shias, normally commemorate the wafat of Imam Hassan on the 7th of Safar. While in Iran and India, they do it on 28th of Safar, along with the wafat of Rasulullah, as I mentioned earlier. But 7th Safar becomes a challenge for us because it is also the Wiladat day of the 7th Imam. So if you are observing 7th Safar as the wafat of Imam Hassan, it also happens to be the Wiladat of the 7th Imam. And so what do you do? Do you go with the issue of celebration or with commemoration? We have to keep in mind that the 7th Safar is still culturally within the days when we are mourning the Shuhada of Karbala till Arba'een. But besides that, you know, this is an issue which has also been center, Maraji, in the last 10, 15 years. In Qom, that there is a narration that Imam Hassan's wafat was on the 7th of Safar, and it's also the day of the Wiladat of Imam Musa al-Kazim alayhi salam. What do we do? Do you give preference to the wafat, or you give preference to the Wiladat? Most of the Maraji, all of them, including Ayatollah Waheed Khurasani, Lutfullah Safi, Sayyid Muhammad Sadiq Rouhani, Shubairi Zanjani, the late Sheikh Jawad Tabrizi, Ayatollah Bahjat, as well as Marhum Fazil Lankarani, all say that when on the same day you have a celebration and a commemoration, the azah will prevail over the celebration. And they, you know, Ayatollah Bahjat actually reflected in a very interesting way. He says, as a way of precaution, he says, have a majlis-e azah, majlis for Imam Hassan alayhi salam, recite his masaib, but narrate the fazail of Imam Musa al-Kazim on that day. So you know, you beautifully combine both events. So you have zikr of Imam Musa al-Kazim alayhi salam, ending with the masaib of Imam Hassan alayhi salatu wasalam. Salawat manik bala. This also gives us the message that, you know, when it comes to our own personal events, birthday or anniversaries and this and that, sometimes, you know, because the Islamic calendar moves, you know, it doesn't go with the common calendar all the time. And all of a sudden you realize it is Muharram time and it's your anniversary date. What do you do? Delayed. Delayed after Arbaeen, there is no problem. Maybe your life will be prolonged for those few days. You know, if this is the intention of delaying it. And when it comes to even celebration of children, sometimes say, Maulana, is, you know, our children, well, from childhood, you have to inculcate this value. That yes, this year your birthday is coming on the Ashura of Muharram, but we will either celebrate this early, before Muharram or after. So they get this message from very beginning that when it comes to these situations of tension between our own personal, you know, occasion and those related to the Ahlul Bayt, you know, this is where the preference has to go to the Ahlul Bayt and the Prophet. You know, otherwise we'll end up with a very unfortunate example I was told by Maulana in U.S. that a family came to him, you know, coming from very good background, but it seems this generation gap was there. And the prom night of this daughter of the Shia family happened to be in the Ashra Muharram, and she wanted to go. And the parents were saying, you can't do this. And they are arguing there in front of the Maulana. At the end, the daughter says, you know, this event is coming in my life only once. Your Ashura comes every year. Look at the words that she's choosing, your Ashura. Means the parents really have not transferred the values to the daughter. For her, Ashura has nothing to do with herself. And she is saying it's your Ashura. This is where we realize that, you know, when we talk about these issues where sometimes conflicts come in, we have to think about it and mentally prepare our children that, you know, the feelings, the emotions about the Muhammad and Ali Muhammad takes preference in our life when it comes to our own personal events. Salawat. Now, when we go back to this issue of seventh Safar, wafat of the second Imam, wiladat of Imam Musa al-Kazim. In East Africa, if you look at the old calendars there, Probably even now they have the same thing. You will see that the 7th of Rajab is dedicated as the day of Imam Musa al-Kazim. It's not his Wiladat. And his Wafat also happens at the end of Rajab, which we commemorate. So where does this 7th of Rajab come from? Somebody in East Africa with a very good intention, he said, you know, we have this Wafat of the second Imam on 7th Safar, but because it is Wafat, we don't celebrate Imam Musa al-Kazim Wiladat. So then, you know, in his mind, probably, you know, they have a fair there called Saba Saba every year. So he said, okay, 7th Imam, 7th month, which is Rajab, and 7th day. So somebody brought this idea, and the community there liked it, and they put that in the calendar. The reason why we don't do it here is because I'm afraid 2 generations from now, they will look at our own old calendars, and if they say, okay, 7th Rajab, Imam Musa Kazim Day, they will say, maybe this is a printing mistake. It should be Imam Musa Kazim Wiladat Day. In order to avoid that confusion, we have removed that from the calendar. Because I already see that. People say, oh, what happened? We didn't have the, you know, Wiladat Day of Imam Musa Kazim on 7th Rajab. Well, it's not Wiladat Day of the Imam. I wouldn't have a problem, and we should be designating the Thursday of that week about Imam Musa Kazim alayhi salam, but to put that in the calendar creates more confusion for the generations to come. And so this was the point that we wanted to have this discussion. Let me now conclude. I wouldn't take much of your time here. Number one, we should know that not all the historical events are unanimous in our history books. Let us celebrate the diversity. We must have this tolerance, you know, when it comes to different, you know, ethnic Shia communities doing the events, some of the events at different times. And there is no need to, you know, blindly follow somebody who comes from, and I don't mean to disrespect anyone here, comes from the Middle Eastern area. Oh, maybe, you know, we have learned all this from Hindus. And maybe they are more right. There's nothing like that. There have been scholars in all communities, and they have preferences based on the differences which are there in the ahadith. These are all ilmi issues. They have nothing to do with the cultural or the, you know, ethnicity of individuals. And remember, when we look at all these events, not all the events were commemorated or celebrated in the same way, all the way back to the days of the Aimma. No. Many things have gradually evolved, and there is nothing wrong with it. You know, we get opportunity more to educate ourselves religiously. But you have to keep in mind that, you know, things were not always the way we observed the events historically, all the going back to the early centuries of the Shi'i history. I'll give you one example of just a generation before. My late father, Allama Sayyid Akhtar Rizvi, is known for his expertise in the history of Islam. You know, his first journey to East Africa is very interesting. In late 50s, he traveled for the first time. You know, we come from North India in an Urdu-speaking community. He was not that much into interaction with the Gujarati or Bombay community. And for the first time, he's traveling from Bombay by sea all the way to Dar es Salaam, about 2.5 weeks' journey to a new land, new community, with differences in language and culture. He lands after that journey in Dar es Salaam, and he was actually invited for the Dar es Salaam Jamaat. Now see what happens. He lands, people come to welcome him at the seaport, and the Mukhi Sahib said, Maulana, aaj raat ko Janab Zainab ki majlis hai. Now, this was probably the fifth of Jamaat al-Ula. In North India, Wiladat of Bibi Fatima, Bibi Zainab, and the Wafat of Bibi Zainab, those days was not an event. It was not commemorated or celebrated. Wiladat as well as Wafat. This is what I wanted to bring this point, that not everything was what we do now was being done for centuries, no. And my father, being an alim, qualified alim, very well versed with history, you know, lands after this long journey to the first new place, and even the language difference is there. In Urdu, if it is a azadari and mourning commemoration, we say majlis. If it is celebration, in Urdu we say mahfil. So the word majlis and mahfil are used differently. A Mukhi Sahib says, Maulana, aaj raat ko Janab Zainab ki majlis hai. This young alim, you know, traveling from India by sea for 2.5 weeks, lands there, goes on the minbar, recites the majlis, ends with gham and masail. Whereas locally it was supposed to be a viladat. You can realize what was the reaction there. They started questioning his, you know, credibility and everything. And there were some other factors also involved. Anyway, we don't want to go into that. They basically were not happy. And he was then sent to Lindi. Later on, they come to know about him. It took them 5 years to try to get him back into Dar es Salaam. But this is an example to keep in mind that, you know, the way we do things now does not mean from, you know, today till about going to 1,200 years, you know, everything was exactly observed in the same way. And so this is where, let me end with one more point of reflection here. Look at the viladat of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We do it on 17th Rabiul Awwal. And the Shias are unanimous on this issue. There's no dispute. Sunnis do that on 13th of Rabiul Awwal, a week before. And sometimes, you know, our people get overexcited. Why can't we unite and this and that? You know, somebody just a few months ago came to know that, oh, in Usul al-Kafi, there is a statement saying that Rasulullah's viladat was on 13th. And so he got very, you know, overexcited, started sending emails. This is what we should be doing, unite with the Sunnis. What he didn't realize that Sheikh Kulaini had mentioned his opinion. There was not a single hadith in Usul al-Kafi from the Ma'asum which says that Prophet was born on 13th of Rabi. No. So this is a matter of unanimity. And this is where, let me end with this very interesting comment from one of our past scholars, Al-Irbili, in his book, Kashf al-Ghumma. He says, "In ikhtilafihim fi yawmi wiladatihi sahlun." He says, the difference of Muslims on his birth anniversary date is easy because they didn't know him when he was born. They didn't know he's a Rasul or that he will become a Rasul. And they were mostly illiterate people. They didn't know how to read and write. The birth days of their children was not normally, you know, preserved there. He says, I am more surprised about the difference among Muslims about his day of death. At least when the Prophet died, all Muslims knew him. If they have a problem in, you know, differences on his birth anniversaries, I can understand, he says, but I can't understand why they have dispute on which day he died. He says, I have even more surprise because there were things he used to do every day. When it comes to the Adhan and Aqama and how he used to pray every day, still they are not unanimous on this issue. And so this is a musibah that we have. But we always go back to this principle, Ahlul Bayt Adra Bil Bayt. The family knows about itself better than outsiders. And if the Imams of Ahlul Bayt are telling us that the Prophet was born on the 17th of Rabiul Awwal, that is the statement we will take from the family of the Prophet and not from anyone else. I'll conclude here with just an example from Imam Musa Kazim alayhi salatu wasalam before we open up for question answers. Many times when we face challenges and difficulties in life, we are overcome with it. But we have to realize life without challenges can become very boring. So difficulties will come, challenges will come. We have to overcome that and not let the challenges, affect us in that way. Imam was put into prison by Harun Rashid. And his spies were there to see, how he conducts himself, what he does. And among the reports, it was very interesting that the very first day, he stands on the musalla and does a dua, which is very interesting. He says, "O Allah, I thank you for this opportunity. I always longed for the opportunity where I could worship you without any other distraction. Today, I have this opportunity." Being put in a prison is not a good thing. But Imam is turning that negative into a positive. And he's thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for it, that, now I don't have to worry about anything. I'm here, and I will be able to worship you more calmly and as long as I want. A saying to end this talk that I have with from the Imam, where he says, "اعمل لدنياك كأنك تعيش عبدا." He says, for the sake of your dunya, work hard as if you are going to live here forever. "وعمل لآخرتك كأنك تموت غدا." And work for your akhira as if you're going to die tomorrow. If you can have that balance, you will be able to use this dunya to build your akhirah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept our ibadat and increase our tawfiqat, inshallah. It's your time to ask questions now.
Assalamu alaikum. Can I request one loud salawat for Sayyidina? Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Inshallah, hopefully this is the first Thursday that we have chosen to celebrate the life of Imam al-Qadim alayhi salam. And inshallah, hopefully in the years to come, we will dedicate that the Thursday after Laylatul Raghaib to our seventh blessed Imam. We're going to open up the floor for questions. We'll have a mic both on the ladies and gents side. If you do have a question, we'll probably take maybe about 5-10 minutes to take questions, and then we'll have a qasida and then ziyarat, inshallah. So if you have any questions, please do raise your hand and we'll pass the mic around.
Assalamualaikum. Jab Prophet Musa Prophet Khizr ke saath the, aur jab Prophet Khizr ne ek bachcha ko mara tha, aur jab unhone bola tha ki is bachcha wo like bade hokar wo like bura kaam karega, to phir like Allah Subhanahu wa Taala bolta hai ki ke aap like aapke paas choice hoti hai, like aap change kar sakte hain apna path, to phir Prophet Khizr ne kyun mara jab wo change kar sakta tha apna path, to uske paas choice thi ya nahi thi?
Okay, the question is good, but it needs more elaborate response and explanation. Inshallah, come and see me at the end, we'll talk about it. Or I'll refer to a video I have on that issue, on that question. Alaykum as-salam. Alaykum as-salam.
I have a question in regards to the faith and the practicality in our lives. When you just referred in the end in your majlis to the sufferings that we all have to go through, if we were to learn from the Ahlul Bayt, I feel that there is a disconnect, because I feel that the Ahlul Bayt and the prophets and the imma, they were sent with that level of conviction that their suffering in this world only made their faith better. But there's a lot of instances in our lives where our suffering does not take us close to God, does not make our faith better. On the contrary, it takes us away and causes us to rage against the Lord, causes us to blame and do loma, you know, against our circumstances, things that are outside of our control. And we may even feel angry about having lost that faith that we may have had when we were teenagers and we would have that zeal for. So how do we know that anything for sure?
Whether this suffering can help us to get close to Almighty God or not, it again depends on the perspective of the individuals and how he or she looks at it. This is the point I had from the example of Imam Musa Kazim alayhi salam, that you take a situation and look at what is positive in it. Because if you just linger on the negative of it, you will be depressed. You will not be able to come out of it. The other example that I mentioned before is Bibi Zainab. Ibn Ziyad in Kufa, when they were brought, just as 2 days after Karbala, you know, he is taunting her that, what do you think about God, what he has done to your brother and your family? And remember her words, مَا رَأَيْتُ إِلَّا جَمِيلًا. When you talk about God, she says to Ibn Ziyad, I have not seen anything but beauty. And the way I would explain that even when, you know, for example, you look at the suffering of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, when he lost his infant child, the grief was there. For Ibn Ziyad, that grief was his victory. For Zainab, for Imam Hussein alayhi salam at that time to still utter the words, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un, ridhan bi qawa'i wa tasliman li amri, was the positive side of it. And that's where she says, you know, ma ra'aytu illa jamilan. So you can take any event, even though it is apparently totally negative, but you can always turn it around. And this is what we have to do. And this is what we learn from the Ahlul Bayt. Anything to do with the dates and historical dates, or even the Shadi events, you know, sometimes we make it things. Maybe I should probe you to ask these questions.
Actually, Maulana, assalamu alaikum.
Yes.
I do have a question relating somewhat to the topic that you presented, this this relation about 1,200 years back. I've been curious about how, during the times of the Imams, how did they commemorate and celebrate? Like, I think the celebrations I can visualize, but, you know, the eight Imams that came after the third Imam, and then, of course, the 12th Imam, like, did they have, you know, majalises of the setting that we have? Like, what was the construct of their, you know, commemorations then, at that time?
After the events of Karbala, as far as Imam Hussein alayhi salam is concerned, the commemoration was there in form of poetry and marsiya mostly. Well, for example, even the sixth Imam, when a poet came to visit him, about whom the Imam knew that he, you know, says good poetry in the about the tragedy of Karbala, he said, you know, I would like to hear from you. And then the Imam asked his servants to erect a curtain and asked the ladies of the family to come on the other side. And then this, you know, marsiya starts. And so we already see that when it comes to the issue of remembering the tragedies, or even the happy occasions where you do certain amal, or you do namaz, or you greet one another, not an event as such, not a gathering as such, during that era of the Aimma, no. It was not even politically possible at that time. Azad, to some extent, was possible, but celebrations, no. But the issue that for them to tell us that we would like you to keep our issues alive, when he says, Amruna is referring to these important events. Like, for example, the first public celebration for Ghadir only happened after the beginning of the Ghaybat-e-Kubra. In Baghdad, when Ali Buya, a Shia inclined, you know, ministers who were actually in power, the Khalifa those days was a puppet. And because of their influence, the Shias were allowed to celebrate Ghadir publicly for the first time in history. So this is what I'm saying. Don't always think that what we do now exactly has been going on. No, it depends on the socio-political, you know, circumstances.
Assalamu alaikum. What is the significance of the 22nd Rajab and the Sufra? Like, what's the historical significance around that?
22nd Rajab and the Sufra that we have, or in Indian subcontinent they call it Kunda, in the name of Imam Jafar Sadiq alayhi salatu wasalam. This is a purely South Asian Shia tradition. You ask the Iranians, they say, what? We don't know anything about it. You ask the Arabs, they wouldn't know what about it. Now they are hearing about it, that in India and Pakistan they do this. Historically, we don't have any confirmed hadith about it, but under the general principle that if you call the mu'mineen to your house and serve them, you know, food or sweets in the name of Imam Ja'far Sadiq, there is no prohibition for it. And do it. Did something happen on that day? Historically, well, it's the day when Muawiyah was gone. So there's nothing to do with the life of the Ahlul Bayt. Yeah. Salam.
Yeah, I just had a question about the waqifa, the waqifiyya during, or I guess after the death of the seventh Imam alayhi salam. You know, there seems to be some, maybe, I don't know if it's a book, but Nusrat al-Waqifiyya, or there seems to be some hadith, you can say, on the belief system of those people about how the seventh Imam may be considered the Qaim alayhi salam of the time. What is the belief system of this group? And, you know, I've seen them kind of being reactivated recently, but anyways, What do we know about that? And are there any kind of hadith considering the seventh imam as the 12th?
Just to make sure everybody understands what the question is, the brother is asking about a group which emerged and they lived very short after the seventh imam, and they are known as waqifa. Waqifa, you know, from waqf. Waqf means to stop. And this was a group which emerged after the wafat of the seventh imam, claiming that imamat has stopped with him, and he is the Mahdi. This was actually started by, unfortunately, a couple of wakala of the imam. They were agents of the imam to collect his, wujuhat and the religious dues. And when the seventh imam passed away, Imam Rida alayhi salam sent them a letter saying that you have certain, money which belongs to me now. Most of them, accepted the eighth imam as the imam, but there were two of them who actually their niyyah changed. Shaitan misguided them, and they said, what imam you're talking about? Your father was the last imam, and that's it. And they refused to hand over the money. And they actually even approached another prominent wakil to say, if you join with us, we'll share the money that we have kept with you also. And he refused. And so that was a small group which continued for about two generations or so. But then they ended. There's no more waqifa after that. Means by the time of the Ghaybat al-Sughra, the waqifa were no more. Recently, there are some people who don't know how to read the hadith properly. They are fitting some of the hadith about al-Mahdi on the seventh imam. But technically, this group doesn't exist anymore.
Assalamu alaikum, Maulana. My question is regarding the number of days you mentioned, 77 and 90, where there were the differences regarding the death or the wafat of Bibi Fatima. So if you take 70 days from the time of the death of the Prophet, and 75, 90, right? So in between.
No, 75, 95.
95.
So 5 was not an issue.
Okay, so.
Next, word was the problem.
So my question is that during that period, there was times where the month had 29 days and 30 days. So how did the date set on that particular date of 3rd of Jamad al-Akhir? Because that could have changed 1 or 2 days here and there, depending on how it was, right? So how did they decide on having that one date instead of having the different dates which were possible at that time?
I don't think there was ever an issue whether it is 3rd or 2nd or 3rd or 4th. There were no controversies of Chan those days, the way we have now. So if you look at it, I have it there actually, the breakdown of how it was done. But no, there's no dispute on whether it was 2nd or 3rd and 4th. It's either 3rd or it is 13th and not, 12th or 14th. The reason why, there are scholars who prefer the 3rd Jamadi Sani, including I concur with that group, because there are some circumstantial evidence. Not a statement from the Masumeen, but in the narration of the janazah which was taken out that night, there is mention of a person holding mash'al, torch. If you live in a village where there's no electricity, if you come out on the eve of, 13th or 14th of the lunar month, it is so bright. You don't need a torch or lantern or, you know, mash'al. But if it is the third of the lunar month, it is dark. And so that becomes circumstantial evidence to support that narration of 95 days as opposed to 75 days. If the seventh Imam's birthday is not mentioned in the calendar, then children will ask, when is his birthday? Better to mention that on 7th Rajab and put in footnote that because of the grief of Safar, we change the date. I would really do the other way around. I'll still put it on 7th Safar, Wiladat and Wafat, and put a note there that the Wafat will prevail as far as observation of the ceremonies are concerned. Because if you put it in Rajab, which is not really, there's no narration at all, you are establishing something which is not true.
So I think we have a couple of questions on the ladies' side, and then we'll wrap it up. The program is taking a little longer than we had planned. So last two questions on the ladies' side, and then we wrap up.
What is the significance of Nowruz?
What is the significance of Nowruz? Nowruz is the Iranian New Year, which happens on the 21st of March every year. And so it's just like 1st January for the common calendar. The Iranian calendar begins with the Nowruz, means the new day or the new year. And so religiously, it doesn't really have much of an impact. There are some ahadiths which talk about a namaz and a dua at that time. But the rest of the celebration of Nowruz is more an Iranian cultural issue rather than Shia religious tradition. Now, sometimes we hear in people from India and Pakistan also observe it. They say, oh, Ghadir happened on that day. First of all, check that. No, Nowruz and Ghadir were not on the same day. They are, I think, 2 or 3 days apart, unless we have this chant problem there. Then, but it is not. And even if it coincided with that, even a common, you know, calendar date would have coincided with Ghadir. But we don't observe that. We only observe Ghadir as 18th of Dhul-Hijjah, not according to the Qamari Iranian calendar or the common Gregorian calendar.
Assalamu alaikum, Maulana Sahib. Thank you very much for this session. My question is that if we are raising our children over here away from the Arab world and the subcontinent, what kind of etiquettes can we teach them when it comes to commemorating and celebrating the birthdays and the wafats of our imams?
I think most of the ways we do things are common. There are some cultural differences. Arabs are more into, you know, clapping, and you do that here in the Imambara, you get into trouble. So, you know, I don't think that one is right, the other is wrong, or because, let's say, they are from the Arab background, therefore we should also do it. There is nothing like that. I think every community has their own cultural way of observing things. As long as they are not contrary to the Sharia laws, it is fine. I think only time will tell when 2 or 3 generations from now, the Shia community at that time will neither be Indian, you know, Canadian Shia or Pakistani Canadian Shia or Iranian Canadian Shia, they will just be Canadian Shia. There you will see maybe merging of some of the traditions, and maybe a new Canadian Shia culture will come up.
Yeah. Can I request Munawar Bhai to please come forward for a qasida followed by ziyarat? Please welcome him with one salawat, please.